You know, hey, listen, what great music. It's so good to see so many people in the room today. I can feel more energy, and I can see that with that good music that some of you are like, you were really ready to cut loose, but you wouldn't do it. I saw some of you guys, you were standing there like, you wanted to dance, but you wouldn't do it. That's okay. It's good to be together in the house of the Lord. Thank you for coming today. I want to start with a question. It's a question I've been asking myself. I'm going to ask you today, too, as well. Raise your hand, either here in the room or online as you're watching. Raise your hand if you have ever said, God, tell me what I am to do. Raise your hand if you've ever done that. Yeah. Now, if you didn't raise your hand, look to that person sitting next to you and say, yeah, you have. Do it. Go ahead, because I know some of you didn't raise your hand. Yes, you have. Every one of us at some point in our life, we have asked the question, God, what is it that you want me to do? What do you want me to do, God? I'm trying to figure this out as best I can, and I really do have a heart that wants to please you, but I don't know what to do here. Well, does God have a plan for us? Does God have a plan for our church? Does he have a plan for his children? Is it a general plan? Is there an actual plan for each one of us that God has? I mean, that's what we're going to explore in the next 4 weeks. Be thou my vision. God, what is your plan for us? And so I start today with that famous scripture that most of us have either had written in our Bibles, underlined, we've had it on a keychain or a t-shirt or a bumper sticker or something, from Jeremiah 29:11. But here's what I want to do. I want to fill it out for you just a little bit before I get to it, because we need to know the context of it. So the prophet Jeremiah, who was pretty much, if you've ever read Jeremiah, it was a doom and gloom kind of prophecy. He didn't really want to share the prophecy because it was a bad word, but he knew he had to. And so he's writing in Jeremiah 29, starting in verse 10. He's quoting what the Lord has told him to say. And here's what it says. This is what the Lord says. You will be in Babylon. They're going to carry him away into Babylon in exile for 70 years. But then I will come and do for you all the good things I have promised, and I will bring you home again. Here's the famous line. Everybody knows this. You could probably quote it with me. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. But you got to read on. You got to read on. Because then it says, in those days, when you pray, I will listen. If you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me. I will be found by you, says the Lord. I will end your captivity and restore your fortunes. I will gather you out of the nations where I sent you and will bring you home again to your own land. I mean, you know, we know this passage. We've kind of grown up with it. We've been around it a lot. But we still ask the question, God, what do you want me to do? Do I take the job? Do I move to the new city? Do I buy the house? Do I end this relationship? Do I change college majors? I mean, we ask all these questions. God, what do you want me to do? Do I pursue this particular medical plan that maybe is laid out in front of us for some of us? And then, you know, should I even be going to this event that's coming up, Lord? And you've probably asked those kind of questions and others. And here's the thing. Sometimes when I ask those questions, you know what I feel like I'm doing? I'm like, Lord, I know I'm bothering you. I mean, you've got such big things on your radar right now. And, you know, this little thing really doesn't ultimately matter maybe in the long run. Am I bothering you, Lord? Have you ever been there? And then we come to church and we sing songs like, we started with today, but we sing it maybe in the traditional church. You know, Be Thou My Vision. That song that we sing is a beautiful hymn. And we feel like, well, Lord, I want you to be my vision. But then we feel like we're flying blind. It's like, I can't figure this out, Lord. Why is it so difficult? Why is it so hard sometimes to figure out what God wants me to do? Why is it confusing even at times? You know, the Bible does say that God has plans for us. He has a vision for us. He often refers to it as God's will for us. And as you study the will of God, here's what you're going to learn. There are a lot of people that have a whole lot of opinions about it. And in fact, Jamie said last week, she was talking about you could check with Dr. Google on the internet. Check Dr. Google. Well, you could probably check theologian Google as well. And you're going to find all kinds of things. And you're going to hear people say things like this. They're going to say, does God have a plan for us? The answer is no. I actually read that again this morning. I was just going back over, looking again, and it said no. And the reasoning was, you know why they said no? They said no because God doesn't exist. There is no God. So your idea that God has a plan for you is foolishness. And I thought how sad that is that somebody actually believes that. I mean, what's life worth then? I mean, what are we doing here if there is no plan or no vision or no will? And then you're going to read others who are going to say, oh, there's all kinds of different levels of will. I'll talk about that in just a few minutes. You know, and it's, you know, we don't necessarily know what God's will is. We just have to just, you know, go in faith, and you'll hear things like that. But then you'll hear others who says, no, God has a plan for us. Let me give you some examples. When Jesus met the disciples on the shoreline, when he first met them, he said something. He planted a vision. He shared with them a vision he had for them individually. Do you remember what it was? He said, follow me. Come follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Now, these were men who were fishing for fish. They had no idea that there was a different plan, a different vision for their lives. And so they lived into it. They dropped their nets, and they followed him. We know also in Jeremiah, I mean, at the very beginning of this book I just read from, when God speaks about Jeremiah and his call to be a prophet, you know what he said? Remember this? He says, this is the Lord speaking to Jeremiah. He says, I knew you before I formed you in your mother's womb. Before you were born, listen to this plan, I set you apart and appointed you as my prophet to the nations. And so God has a plan for us. In fact, Paul writes about that in Ephesians. He says in chapter 5, these three verses, he says, be very careful how you live, not as unwise, but as wise. Now, that sounds like somebody who's looking to live into God's plan for their life. Look what it says. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. And so the Bible's clear about that. We'll share some more of that as we work through this series in the days ahead. But if God has a vision for us, and I believe he does, a will, a plan, a path for us, for our lives, then it makes sense that he wants us to know what that plan is. I don't think he's up there playing games with us. I don't think he's playing, you know, under which cup is the ball, or, you know, hide and seek. I don't think he's playing, you know, what's behind door number 3 with us. He wants us to know his vision for our lives. And having a clear vision of what God wants us to do is important. Andy Stanley wrote a book called Visioneering. I was reviewing it again as I was preparing for this message. And he said this about the vision. Look what he says. He says, a clear vision, along with the courage to follow through, we'll talk about that next week, dramatically increases your chances of coming to the end of your life, looking back with a deep, abiding satisfaction and thinking, I did it. I succeeded. I finished well. My life counted. Now, there's some of you who are very young. You're not even thinking thoughts like that towards the end of your life. But we ought to be at some point because that's the way we want to finish. We want to be able to say at the end of it, I did it. I succeeded. I did what the Lord wanted me to do. I finished well. My life counted. Because Andy went on to say, there's another side of that. There's a flip side to that. Listen to what he says here. He says, missing out on God's plan for our lives might be the greatest tragedy this side of eternity. So it makes me wonder, okay, do you know what God's vision is for you? Have you figured it out? Do you know what His will is for you, His plan for you right now? And here's the thing. I've discovered this in my own life. There's a vision for a season, and maybe you get a vision for another season, and then another season. You know, it's not necessarily that it's the same vision all the way through. That's the way He did with Abraham and others. He said, I want you to go here, and now I want you to go here. He did the same thing in the New Testament. So how do you discover God's vision for your life? I'll spend just a few minutes talking about that. Here's the first thing that stood out for me when it came to trying to understand God's vision. Here's what I need to do. I need to pursue Him just for Him. I need to pursue Jesus just for Jesus. You know, there's no greater pursuit in this life than the pursuit of God. I mean, all other things we can pursue in life, you know, seem to be important and seem to be great, but the greatest pursuit that we have, that we were made for, created for, and intended to do, was to pursue God. A.W. Tozer actually wrote a book called The Pursuit of God, and he's got a good quote. Listen to this one. It says, I want deliberately to encourage this mighty longing after God. Notice what he says next, though. The lack of it has brought us to our present low estate. He's talking about the condition of the human nature and humanity right now. And I believe the same thing applies for us here in today's date, doesn't it? I wonder if that's what's brought us to our present low estate, is that we have not pursued Jesus just for Jesus. So let me ask you, do you pursue Him just for Him? Just to be with Him? Just to have Him in your life? You know, too many times in my life, this is what I've done. I pursued Jesus because I needed something, or I wanted something. It could have been a career goal. It could have been in a relationship. It could have been in all kinds of financial situations where I just pleaded with God, show me what I'm to do here. Show me what I'm to do here because I need this in my life right now. It could be something that we want. It could be that we pursued Him because we were in trouble in some way, or we were struggling in some way, instead of just pursuing Him. And so I've got a book that is one of my go-to books. You probably should know this book. It's called The Will of God by Leslie Weatherhead. Leslie Weatherhead was writing during World War II in London, where they were being bombed by the Germans. And people were trying to understand what God's will was in this great war, World War II. And so Leslie Weatherhead, a minister, a Methodist minister, preached and taught on this idea of the will of God. And years ago, when I was struggling with the will of God, when it came to the death of my sister, a preacher pointed me to this book, and it helped me to understand it. Here's what he says, though, about pursuing Jesus when it's because we need something in our lives. He said this. He said, when the storm is raging, it is too late to talk about the anchor that should have been put down before the storm began. That makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? It's a little too late then to be seeking it. So let me put it another way, this idea of pursuing Jesus just for Jesus. We need to stop asking from Him and just start asking for Him. I don't need anything from you right now, Jesus. I just want you. I just want you in my life, and I just want you and me together right now to spend some time so that I can know you better and I can pursue you just for you. So if we are going to do that, then that's how we're going to grow in our faith. In fact, that's what Paul writes in Colossians in chapter 2. He says this. He says, in the same way you received Jesus our Lord and Messiah by faith, continue your journey of faith. Watch this. Progressing further into your union with Him. It's like the more you pursue Him, the closer you get to Him, and the more you're united with Him. So you want to pursue Him further into union with Him. If you want to know what God wants you to do, start pursuing Him just for Him. And then when the time comes, He'll show you. He'll guide you. That's what it said in Jeremiah 29 when we read it a minute ago. It said, in those days when you pray, I will listen. If you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me. I will be found. And that's what that him be thou my vision. That's kind of the concept that it starts with, and that's the reason I chose it as the title for this sermon series. The hymn in the traditional version says this in the first verse. It says, be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Just that you are. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. I got to pursue him just for him if I'm going to understand what he wants me to do. But here's the next one. I've done this. Maybe you've done this as well. The second one is this. I've got to throw away the rubber stamp. Now, you know what I mean by a rubber stamp, don't you? You know, you've been to meetings where people have just rubber stamped what was asked to be done, or you know, you've always heard that, you know, yeah, they're just going to rubber stamp that. And it's like a rubber stamp. You can see it, and they stamp the piece of paper, and it says, granted. And here's what I mean by this. We come up with all kinds of plans about how God ought to run the world, don't we? Especially when it comes to my life. God, let me tell you, Debbie and I are going to leave the ministry. We're going to leave the law and enter the ministry. And so we're going to go to a school in Asbury, and we're going to sell our house. And we're actually going up there to look at another house. And I'm sure that you're going to be able to, you know, have somebody buy my house so that I can go up there. We're going to put Jim in this school. We had all these, didn't we, Debbie? We had all these plans. And I was just looking for God to rubber stamp it. You know what he did? Denied. I didn't get to go on this great journey that I had in my mind was to be the journey for us. Instead, he put me on another journey. And I have to tell you, it wasn't the one I was wanting, but it's the one I needed to be on. And so we need to throw away the rubber stamp. Here's another way to say it. We need to stop asking him to bless what I want to do and ask him to use me to bless what he wants to do. Yeah. And so there are two proverbs that tell us that this is the way we should be. One of them is Proverbs 16:9. It says this, the heart of man plans his way, but the Lord establishes his steps. And then Proverbs 19:21 says, many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it's the purpose of the Lord that will stand. Isn't that good? Because you know what? Sometimes our plans are not good plans. We think they are. We thought them all out, and we did all of the research, and we did everything we needed to do. We were even praying about it. But God says, that's not the way I want you to go. My purpose is what matters, not yours. We have all kinds of plans. And we're really good at telling God this is what he should do. And I shared this quote with you, I don't know, shortly after I got here, I think, J. Vernon McGee, who I think recently passed away, if I remember right. He had this quote. It's really a great quote. Listen to this. Let me remind you that this is God's universe, and he is doing things his way. You may have a better way, but you don't have a universe to rule. Isn't it true? We think we have our little universes, but we really don't. So it's really about this idea of getting rid of the rubber stamp. It's really about surrender. It's truly about I'm surrendering not only my life, but my plans, my desires, my goals, what I'm looking for. I'm surrendering it to you. I am literally, just as the disciples did, I'm dropping my nets. I'm giving up what I had just to follow you. Psalm 25 speaks to that. It says, show me the right path. In other words, show me your path, Lord, not my path. I've got a great path, I think, planned. But let me submit to you in such a way that you show me actually your path. You point out the road for me to follow. Verse 5 says, lead me by your truth, not mine, your truth. You lead me, Lord, and teach me, for you are the God who saves me. All day long, I put my hope in you. And so we got to be careful not to confuse our plans with God's vision for us. It's called surrender. The key is surrender. A proverb that a lot of people know and go to is in Proverbs chapter 3, and it's a good one. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. So it's an all. You hear that? It's not in some of your ways or with some of your heart, every bit of it. So when I release control, when I surrender like that, it moves me to a deeper level of trust in God through Jesus Christ. I got to get rid of the rubber stamp. I got to pursue Jesus just for Jesus. And then look at this one. This is a strange one, but I like it. I got to do step one before I can expect to make it to step two. Here's what I mean by that. Step one is what I already know God wants me to do. And in order for me to move to the next level, which means the things specifically that he's asking me personally to do, that's step two. Step one is what he wants everybody to do. So we know that. We know that we are to love God. We know that we are to submit to him. We know a lot of the things that we're already supposed to do. So God wants me to start doing what I already know to be his revealed, his known will for my life. That's step one, before he tells me what else to do, which is step two. So there are theologians and scholars and preachers and, you know, seminary professors that have tried to devise ways to understand God's will. And I'm telling you, if you go study it, you're going to see that there are all kinds of ideas out there. In fact, a number of people will divide God's will into three different levels or ideas or understandings of God's will. They have different names for them. One is providential will and moral will and personal will. Another, Leslie Weatherhead says, intentional will, circumstantial will, ultimate will. Another one will say sovereign will, general will, personal will. You got all these ideas. But for us, for the ease of trying to understand God's will, I want to break it down into these two. The first is God's revealed, what I know he wants all Christians, all of his children to do. And then what's his personal will for me, my life? God's personal will for me, because he has one. So in order for me to know God's will for my life, here's what I got to do. I got to first start following his revealed will. I got to start doing what I know I'm supposed to do. I like this quote too from Andy Stanley. He says, it's surrender to the known will of God that paves the way to discovery of the unknown will of God. So that's like step one is the known, unknown is step two. So what is step one really? I mean, it's summarized in the great commandment that Jesus gave us. You know the great commandment. It's in Matthew 22, starting in verse 36. A lawyer comes to him and asks, what's the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. I mean, that's all of you. This is the greatest and most important commandment, he said. The second most important commandment is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. So it's very simple. Step one, understanding what God wants me to do. I got to love God. I got to pursue him. It's like we said a moment ago. I've got to love him and I got to love others. The second verse of Be Thou My Vision says, Be Thou My Wisdom and Thou My True Word. I ever with thee and thou with me, Lord. Thou and thou only first in my heart. You hear the love part? High King of Heaven, my treasure thou art. I got to love him. That's what I've got to do. And here's the reality. God's not obligated to reveal step two until we do step one. He's really not. I mean, why would he? It seems to me that God would say, hey, listen, Jimmy, why would you want me to tell you what to do in this situation when you're not following me in the first place? I mean, you think I'm just a genie, and when you need me, all of a sudden I'll give you what you want? I mean, why don't you just learn to love me first, and then maybe you'll discover what I actually want you to do with that situation, whatever it may be. And so we say things like this. We'll say like, well, God, I want to know. I do. I want to know your will for my career or my marriage or my situation, whatever it may be. And then maybe God's saying, okay, fine. Well, let's do some of the basics, Jimmy. Are you doing those things first? Are you teaching Sunday school when they ask you to? Are you praying? Are you leading your family like a Christian father, husband should be? I mean, are you really loving me right now? Let's get that first. Then I'll show you the next step. So, are there any things that God has told you to do that you just hadn't started doing yet? Jamie said it. She said it well. We love you guys. I mean, as your pastors, I don't think God could have given us more love for this congregation and all of you than we have right now. And as your pastor, let me just tell you this. Stop putting it off. Don't do that. If you're putting it off, if you're not doing the things that you already know God's called you to do, as he's called all of us to do, then start doing it now. Start doing it now. Because when you do, God's going to open up for you all kinds of his beautiful, all areas of his beautiful vision for your life. So stop putting it off. Because here's the truth. You may say, I've been waiting on God. Well, listen, maybe God's waiting on you. Maybe that's where it is. And maybe that's why there's confusion and lack of understanding about his vision right now in our lives. So I've got to do those things. I've got to pursue him. Yeah. And I got to stop, I got to get rid of my rubber stamp. And then I got to really do step number one. And so I want to give you some next steps to practice. I always give those to you. That's on purpose, because I tell you that if we'll take one more step closer to Christ, then our life is going to be better. May not necessarily be easier, but he's going to give us what we need in order to continue to live the life that he's called us to. So I want to start this week. I want to start doing what I know God wants me to do. And then the second one is, I'm going to stop asking him to bless my plans. Unless I know that he gave me those plans. If I know that, heck yeah, I want him to bless them for sure. And then the last one, I'm going to pursue Jesus just for Jesus. But I also wrote out a prayer that I want us to think about praying today as we're seeking God's will. So it'll be up on the screen, I think. Would you pray this with me? You can just say it out loud with me. We'll pray it together. Lord, I need your guidance in my life. I ask in faith that you direct my steps. Help me to listen for your response, to not get so busy that I can't hear you. Father, when I don't understand it, help me to trust you and understand that you have a path that is for my good. Show me my next step. Help me to do what I already know I should do. Help me not get frustrated. Help me to not be fearful, but to trust in you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I want you to stand and sing with us as we close out this.